chair of the Spring Community Alliance. We also have here Tom Conlon on our executive committee, Peter, and Mark Klein is here somewhere. And Dan, not in the boss.
She's not in here.
Okay. So I want to go quickly on the room and everybody introduce themselves because I think our speakers are going to know who we are. So why don't we just start in the front? I'm going to go ahead and introduce. So.
Tom Martin, live in the Springs, represent the Springs on the Citizens Advisory Commission.
And writes for the Gazette.
Beg your pardon?
And writes for the Gazette.
Oh, and write for the Sonoma County Gazette, Spring Splash.
That's right. Good, thank you, Tom.
I go on the beat tomorrow morning.
We'll start with you.
I'm Fred Alvock, and this is my third Hidden in Plain Sight. Study that I've attended.
You can tell us if you get any better.
Larry Davis.
I'm here.
Kathy Wade Shepherd.
I'm Steve Cox.
I'm Asha Shiba, and I live in the Spring.
Okay.
Cindy Scarborough. I live a few blocks away, and it's the first SCA meeting I've made, but the fourth presentation. I beat you, Fred.
I'm Tracy Brayness. I'm a Springs resident. I've heard the Hidden in Plain Sight presentation before, too. I'm looking forward to seeing it again.
Good. Good. Thanks, Ron.
That's Candace Field with 10,000 degrees.
Okay.
Rebecca Hersey of Congressman Thompson's office.
Kevin, what's your
name? Jennifer Ray Thompson, Springs resident. I work for the state.
Rebecca Mary Carmen.
Mary Carmen. Mary Carmen Reyes. The board for SCA and the person of our community health center.
Welcome. Andy Sanchez, community manager at our local center.
So, Cruz Del Rosa. Sorry, SCA. I just couldn't follow the SCA board and Sonoma Valley Hospital. Thank you. Welcome.
Okay, thank you. So I just want to make some comments and announcements before we start the program. I want to encourage everyone to come to the Sunday Farmers Market in town already. We encourage your friends and neighbors to do that. It's really a great little market. It needs help. It needs to grow. And people become aware of where it is and when it is. So it's really great. It's great produce and lots of interesting vendors there. It's also a great place to go sit and have a picture while listening to the music. Good thing, a good way to spend Sunday evening. So please consider joining us at the Farmers Market on Sundays. I think it runs until September 10th, I think it's the last one. So look forward to seeing you there.
What time?
4 to 7 p.m.
Can I add a fantastic feature? If you don't have cash, you can get cash there.
Oh.
Very beneficial. Yes.
Great. Okay.
It's great. Thanks.
Good to know. And I want to announce that we're organizing a Springs Community Cleanup. We've done those in years past. I've done one in a while, but we've had this time and now we've done the sidewalks. It's the Highway 12 project completed. I just didn't see the time to put that together. There's been some issues that have come up around trash collection and getting your streets clean. So that's going to be on September 21st. That's a Saturday. It'll probably be like 9 or 1 or something like that. But I'm in the process of trying to arrange for some three boxes that will be located in the location to be determined, possibly the community parking lot. But we need help getting this organized. It's not something one person or a few people can do on their own. So if, especially if you would like to organize a small crew in your neighborhood, it doesn't have to be this high as well. I would love to have you come forward with email that you'd like to help in some way organize it.
Can we also, can somebody send us a note through our website?
Yeah, or the Facebook, the Springs community page, yes. And you can message me to that, or what's it there, or email. I think the website's also really good.
Rich, thank you for organizing that. It's fabulous. I saw a property owner or maintenance person cutting down the tall grass. That's a huge issue that I see in the Springs. If
Then I wanted to mention, I think most of you have read or heard about the Springs Municipal Advisory Council, the map that's being formed. It's actually more of a countywide program that they're hoping to implement by the end of the year. I think it's a great thing for the Springs and a better structured way for the community to provide input to the Board of Supervisors. And we don't really have all the details yet. I imagine that the representatives will be forming committees to work on specific communities and projects. So I want to mention that because I think we can start organizing and working on those projects now. We really need the community to step up and help get this done. If you want to make your community better, you can't depend on other people. You need to have more participation. So let me just read through, just made this list a couple minutes ago. I'm sure there's more that I'm not remembering, but for example, trash receptacles. Somebody mentioned the trash, along the bike path that's being built, and there's new trash receptacles. And that's true on the plaza area. So I know Jennifer and us have discussed a little bit about that in the past, but we need someone to kind of take that one by the horns and figure out how to get trash receptacles out in the Springs.
I also was a problem in the hub area, and so we had a long conversation with TPW that you may have noticed that they moved out yesterday, and so it looks better temporarily, but we would be glad to work with you, have some ideas on the long-term trash receptacles.
And the Springs cleanup is great for cleaning up for one day, but something needs to be done periodically, so I've actually had a short conversation with Suzanne Schoenberg, who happens to work with Jill, and she's agreed to kind of help organize an ongoing, hopefully business-sponsored Springs cleanup. We did that years ago, becoming independent to do it, and business-sponsored. So I think it's time to bring that back and have a regular delivery program in Springs. Two other things that have come up recently that we need help with. We'd like to request funding from the county and whoever else they give to us for a museum, Spring Museum, and also a library. And so those ideas have been kicking around, but they're not going to go anywhere until somebody comes forward and helps spearhead that, something who has a passion for that idea and wants to help the organize. Traffic calming. There's been a committee group formed recently in Glenelg that has really started to get things done, and they've tapped the traffic calming problem that they have. A simple solution is just a little neighborhood sign, which is a reminder that they have kids here around and there's a community we want to keep it safe. So we're actually in the process of kind of working or communicating with them, see what their ideas are, and see if we can help them at all.
And also, Jennifer Gray also connected me with Veronica. What is your last name? Napoleon?
Napoleon?
Napoleon. So we haven't connected yet, but that's in the works.
The travel calling is one farmer's market. We could use more help promoting our farmer's market and getting people to come. For example, we need to produce a bunch of little flyers that somebody could hand out at the Tuesday farmer's market or any other events that are taken door to door. And it takes a concerted, multifaceted effort for that to catch on. And there's no reason why we can't make that happen. And the last one on the list is just the plaza, the area between post office and Armando's auto repair shop that is now sort of public space since the sidewalks were street is closed off and through there. We need help getting that cleaned up and making it more attractive as a public space. And actually, there's a community forum, including myself, Juan Hernandez, Ruthie Snyder, and a few others who will help. We're trying to get that organized, putting up painting on the paddings and getting some public art there, so we can certainly use help. We can volunteer help or other kinds of help with that. So that's my speech for tonight. Hand over to our guests. So I want to introduce Catherine Fulton from the Snow Valley Fund with Nancy Ramsey. And thank you for coming tonight. They're going to share this presentation on.
Maybe get these fans going here. Yeah, just trying to get the fans going. Hi, everybody. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
I can't believe some of you have heard this presentation multiple times. It's somewhat different. We have learned a lot. This is our learning journey, actually, both doing the report and taking it out into the community. And Sonoma Valley Fund, you have on your chair our recently published annual report, and Peg Van Camp is our president, who's sitting in the back row. And if anybody wants to know more about Sonoma Valley Fund, part of our mission is to increase the amount and effectiveness of philanthropy in the Valley, and to draw attention to issues that philanthropy ought to be paying attention to, which is why we did this report. Nancy and I are going to roll quickly through the high-level findings. You have the executive summary as well. And then we're going to leave plenty of time for conversation. We can even get the chairs around in a circle or something, and because I think there's an awful lot to discuss and think about as we move to the next period in the Valley. We started this project because we heard more and more people voicing one voice or another of this question. How can we preserve and enhance the character of this community while dealing with the growing challenges that we have? And you know, the sense that if you look ahead 10, 15, 20 years, this place could be very different in ways we don't like, but that we still can influence many things to create the community that we want. So, so what is the community? And for the purpose of this report, it's Sonoma Valley. And Sonoma Valley, for the purpose of this report, extends from Sears Point up past Kenwood. And that's a census district. That's a census, what they call a CCD, a census division. And that also almost perfectly maps to the three primary zip codes that we were able to study. So that's what we're talking about. And basically what we've done is we've hired the Sonoma Economic Development Board. This is a really spectacular data report that they did, which is the first thing to look at the problems and how they're changing, the demography of the Valley, all the things having to do with people. And that's an update of a report that was first done in 2011 by the Community Foundation, by the County Economic Development Board for the Community Foundation. We simply updated that 5 years later so we could actually compare the data as well. And for the first time, what we want to do is put that with a look at philanthropy and the nonprofit sector in the Valley, and really begin to look at them together and say what are the challenges that we seem to be addressing well, and what are the ones not so much. And the result of that is this report. The full report is all of this is available online, and the full report does the integration. Gives all the detail about the nonprofit sector and does the integration. What we're going to do tonight is go over the high-level findings. The findings are already, we believe, based on the many conversations we've had, helping donors reflect on their priorities, inspiring nonprofits to look at what they're doing, helping the community as a whole look at its future. What we really want is for the Valley as a whole to seek new and improved approaches to look to address these challenges. And we think that's going to take doing some different things than we do now. The early seeds of change, I think of it this way, the report came out in early May, and we would guess we're about halfway through the process of actually going out into the community and conversations like this. We've had more than 20 meetings and briefings as recently yesterday with Susan Gorin in the county with a number of county department heads. And it's clear that what we want to do is catalyze the conversation and the ideas and figure out what we as the Sonoma Valley Fund, which is just a group of volunteers who are the affiliate of the Community Foundation of Sonoma County, to we can figure out what it is that we can do, but we really want to look at what all of us can do together and how that can add up to more. And some of it may be, you know, by the existing groups, there may we're seeing more and more ad hoc groups forming, and we can talk more about this as we go along. I've got some more at the very end of the report to try to tell you some of the ideas that we're starting to hear and some of the things that are already moving. But before we do that, we want to just give you a quick look, because not everyone has heard the data. Nancy's is going to take that.
I want to thank you for coming. I know this will be stimulating and exciting and just hardly able to contain yourselves. But coming out in an evening is really a difficult thing for all of us, and so we really are grateful. And as Catherine said, it's your input that we really want to listen to, which is why we've done all of these presentations. There are several key findings, and they really are, I'm wearing my glasses. Some of you who have heard this presentation now know that I started this project without glasses, and I now wear trifocals. So it reflects the level of detail that we've done with EPB on this level. Our population is growing faster than the city and the state, which is really very interesting. Certainly we see it in just about every single way, from traffic to the people around. Our population is about 43,000. We're 67% white. We're about 28% Hispanic, and the census uses the terms Hispanic and Latino interchangeably, so they may be interchangeable in the report itself. 2% of our population is mixed race, 2% is Asian, and 1% is other, which basically means it's not enough the number's not large enough to have a separate category. We have a higher proportion of seniors than the county, the state, or the nation. I'm going to say more about that. We now have about 25% of our population over 65. We're increasingly diverse, and that trend is expected to continue and have an impact on possibly the changing nature of our community. We were surprised to find that poverty is growing in spite of the fact that we are at full employment. The EDB says that we're between 3 to 5%, but that's roughly full employment, and despite that, our poverty is increasing. And our access to affordable housing, as you all know, is continuing to be a problem. Perhaps one of the brighter sides and the good notes, and we will not say that this is causal, but both the state, the county, and philanthropy have really focused on youth and education. And we see that there's definitely evidence of progress in that, in terms of graduation levels and everything, other things I'll talk about. As I've said, 25% of the Valley residents are 65 and older, and the increase on that is a 26% increase over the last 5 years, which again is faster than the state or the county. The segments of 16 and under have shrunk in Sonoma Valley, as have the number between 30 and 65. The majority of the under 16s are in the Springs. Whoops, sorry about that. Just shy of 30%, almost 12,000 of our Valley residents identify as Latino. And again, this is census data, so it's self-declaring. Nobody is saying you're this or you're that. This is a self-declaration by people who answer questions on the census. That percent has increased 13.7% since we last did the study. And at the same time, the number of non-citizens has increased by 56%, of which 76% live in the Valley. Just to be clear, the categories are in citizenship, it's a native-born citizen or a naturalized citizen. Other categories are green card holders, refugees, and visa holders, which are H-1B, H-2A, and H-2B. And that means that we have a 56% that is non-citizens here in the Valley. 57% of our school district is now Hispanic children, and that's an increase of 10% over the last 5 years. Interestingly, in that 35% of the Unified School District, English is not, they do not meet the category of English competence, which means they don't, they cannot listen, speak, read, or write in a level that maintains their grade level ability to participate in school. At the same time, the research shows that folks who are foreign born, that are 5 years, older than 5 years old, 60% do not have what they consider a fluency in English. So the report shows this continuing shift. The number of families in poverty has increased by 70%. That's a pretty staggering number. The background of that is 24,000 is what the federal government says is a poverty level for a family of four. Here in Sonoma Valley, it's a 1.85% measure, which brings us up to about 25,000. It's estimated that 52,000 is needed for a family of four to live in Sonoma Valley, just above poverty level. And a family, according to the census, is considered people who are related and living in the same domicile. Almost 20% of our families with children live at or below the poverty line, and poverty in the Springs is 52% higher than it is in the rest of Sonoma Valley. Income disparity is growing. 9% of our population makes $100,000 or more as a filing. 4% are $200,000 or more. At the same time, I should say 31% are at $100,000 or more. 31% are at $35,000 or less. So that disparity has grown over time. And the level of poverty related to the high proportion of employment in low-wage sectors is obvious. The lowest wage, and this is the report has a really good breakdown on who works where, but the lowest pay scales are in service and agriculture and food work, and that's primarily where people in the Springs are working. So basically, when you cut it, two people working in a family at minimum wage don't reach above the poverty level. One of the other interesting things is that the rate of is five times higher for Latino households than white. Poverty rates for Hispanic is 19%, for whites it's 4%. And the growth in poverty for Latinos is up 16% and down 4% down 9% to 4% for whites. One of the interesting things here is that the link between high school graduation and the ability to earn an income that is above poverty is an absolutely clear link. There's absolutely no question about that. And we're in a situation where 4% of the whites in the valley have not graduated from high school, but 50% of the Hispanics in the valley have not graduated from high school, and that's a correlation in, together with what the pay scales are to what's happening in terms of the ability to earn an income above a poverty level. This you can see, this you've experienced when you look at that top line and you see the yellow line and the collapse. What we know is that the vacancy rates have fallen. We know that rates for both rental and ownership are down. Real estate professionals consider this a 3% is really considered full occupancy. 50% on average, 50% of our valley population pays more than 35% of their income for housing. It's pretty staggering. So, on the good news in the education front, I'm not going to run through these all. There's pretty much in the summary, but basically, we've really increased the preschool enrollment up to about 66% to 68%. And again, like high school graduation, there's a direct correlation between participation in preschool and success later in terms of education. We have Latino students are continuing to close the gap. We, in every single form of graduation, from graduations in high school to passing the California high school exit exam. And what's really good is that we're well above the state average in terms of high school graduations, up to 90%. So there are more challenges on the self-declared study that the children do. There's high-risk behavior that includes drinking, drugs, and to our surprise, bullying was one of the things that came up that the kids declared that they felt was a problem for them in school. It isn't really because I worked with EDB. It really is full of all kinds of information that will be really interesting, helpful, and useful to you. There's more in population on the growth of non-citizens. Workforce information is fairly well detailed, and the educational results and the achievement gap, plus more, more, and more.
And we titled this report Hidden in Plain Sight because I'm sure that very little of that was a surprise to anybody, but it's really good to get the detail that fills it in. What we then paired this with, if you think of that as the demand side, was the supply side. What are we doing? And again, just to be clear, we only studied the Sonoma nonprofits that filed with the federal government, a form called 990s, from the organizations that were located in those three zip codes that are in the valley. So all the nonprofits that, you know, they're nonprofits that work here who are located in Santa Rosa, a good example would be the Land Trust, does work in the valley, but we didn't study those because it would have required researching organization by organization. And I think 10,000 Degrees is another example of an organization we're not able to study in detail, but that is providing a service here. And we think that's actually one of the important things to look at, which we'll get at in a second. So what you're looking at, what I'm about to report to you, is entirely 100% publicly available data in 990 tax forms that any of you want to look at, but I can tell you putting them together is not an easy matter. As Nancy said, we're looking at poverty, we're looking at aging, we're looking at housing, and the big problems, and then we put that together with what's actually in what we think of as the charitable economy. The charitable economy, this was probably the biggest surprise to us, was just how large it is overall, and that it grew quite rapidly in the last 5 years. I'm gonna walk you through what this chart is. The total size 2 years ago when the data was available, the data we could get when we did the study, it's already 2 years old and it's $113 million. That's all the revenue of all kinds, earned charity, you know, earned government grants and reimbursements and philanthropy. Along the bottom here, the larger Sonoma Valley nonprofits, that's about 60 organizations that file 990s. That means they have revenue of $50,000 or more in a given year. That's roughly 36 million. Sonoma Valley Hospital and Hannah Boyce Center are both technically not nonprofits that file 990s. Hospital is a quasi-governmental, but does, for the purposes of this study, was raising money for its building during the period of the study. Hannah Boyce Center is mostly not supported with philanthropy from the Valley, but it's an important nonprofit here, and its budget is $11 million. And then there are all the churches. That's a guess, $6 million. It's probably larger than that. And churches are not entirely philanthropy, you know, supported with contributions, but mostly. And then Sonoma County operating nonprofits, that's the guess at $4 million, looking at the nonprofits we know that are located elsewhere, like the Land Trust, like 10,000 Degrees, like the food bank, you know, any number of nonprofits that are located elsewhere that operate here, guess of what portion of their budget is here. And then smaller nonprofits is all the PTOs and the festivals and all the things that are really small, that don't file. So that's how you get to 113 million. By contrast, the budget for the city of Sonoma every year is 31, this year is $31 million.
The hospital is just the hospital foundation?
No.
It's hospital foundation plus?
Yeah, that's the hospital itself, right? Because it's essentially the largest nonprofit in Sonoma. So we didn't want to do the study and not, I mean, but you can see it's about half the total. The hospital foundation, there are two, there's the hospital foundation, the Ed Foundation in Sonoma, and the Ed Foundation in Kenwood, I think it is, are all in the larger nonprofit because they raise money, they happen to give it a particular place, but they don't do grants programs or, you know, that sort of thing. We're not counting in that number, for instance, though. Impact 100 is not does not show up there as a separate count because it would be double counting the money because their money then goes into some of these organizations, right? If you then look, there's just a couple of these. There's a lot of data in the report itself, and I don't want to dwell on this because I know so many people have seen this already, but there are two cuts of the data I want to show you. One is just how important giving is to nonprofits in the valley. So it's roughly, you know, this is the whole, again, it's 113 million, roughly, you know, just under a third of the money comes from all of us opening our checkbooks and writing checks. Programs and services means when people are actually paying for services. So tickets, reimbursements, so in that case it would actually include somebody goes to the community health center and it's reimbursed by Medicaid, right? That kind of thing. So, and then actual grants from the government, like the city's grant programs is something, other income, membership dues. Contributions to fundraising events is not as large a number overall as it seems, given how many fundraising events there are in the Valley. For some particular organizations, including this one, fundraising events are enormously important to their budget. It's just that the overall charitable economy relies less on fundraising events than it may seem. Plus, contributions were up in this five-year period, 7%. Now, the focus is also interesting. It's clear that the number one issue is everything having to do with youth and education, roughly 40% of the total in terms of where the money goes. And this is just the charity. So we're double-clicking on that 30%, and of the 30%, where does that 30% go that people give their money to? And the number one thing is youth development. The number two thing is health, various things. For the purposes of the report, it's really interesting to look at how these things sync up. So the seniors up there would be Vintage House, because it's the only organization entirely dedicated to seniors. That doesn't mean that's, you know, in some of these other categories, like health and basic human needs, there's certainly money that goes to seniors. One of the things we know for sure is that it has to be studied more deeply to understand both the senior need, what the services are, and where the gaps might actually be. You'll notice that there's nothing for housing. Sonoma Valley has no organization right now dedicated to housing and working on housing issues. It does have an organization that works on homelessness that shows up in basic human needs. But overall, the overall amount of money that goes to deal with poverty, although again, there's poverty in some of the other categories, is only about 14%. And the organizations that that work on poverty the most rely more heavily on philanthropy because they can't charge for your services, right? So, and the other thing that's worth pointing out is it's very clear that one of the biggest gaps in Sonoma is the need for advocacy of all kinds, right? So you basically have small nonprofits that don't have, they're in the service business, and when it comes to showing up in Santa Rosa at the county supervisors to say what the valley needs or figuring out how to advocate to the city for things, there's almost no dedicated capacity to that. So those are some of the gaps. And this is the last piece of this, and we think this is extremely important. There's a lot more data, but I'm just highlighting some things. The nonprofit sector here, while the overall economy is very large, Most of the organizations are very small. There are only about a dozen organizations located in the Valley that have a budget of about $1 million or more. Most of them are much smaller, and most of them live with no reserves. The average amount of money at the end of 2014 that all of the 60 organizations we could study had was 3 months. Many of them had nothing, and most the organizations, there were only six organizations that accounted for 50% of the money that any of the nonprofits had on hand. So what you have is people who are working like this day after day after day, providing services, the demand for which is growing, with very little capacity to look beyond doing what they're already doing. So a high stress situation. And there are essentially, except for the health center and increasingly Transcendence Theater, there are virtually no nonprofits of any scale in this valley. And both of those are, you know, in the multi-million dollar level. And of course the hospital is in its own category. So in terms of just getting us into the conversation, I want to say that just the data itself, what was wrong, is hidden in plain sight, and what the challenges are. But and the fact that they're not being addressed adequately or likely to keep growing. So we know that. That's hidden in plain sight. The overall effort of the community, the amount of caring and effort that goes on in terms of giving, volunteering, giving money, volunteering time, all the work that people who work in the nonprofits put forward, all of it's impressive. And we still struggle to achieve the scale and sustainability that we need. Size, interdependence, and complexity of the challenges is growing. So the things that Nancy described about poverty, you know, these are things that can only be looked at with looking at multiple kinds of solutions. As a friend of mine likes to say, there are no silver bullets, there's only silver buckshot. And these things are how it is that we get coordination among nonprofits and between and among nonprofits and government to make sure that we're using the resources that are available better to deal with these complex challenges is extremely important. And the other thing that's very striking that is quite obvious is that as a community we have not invested in the information that we would need to actually understand what's most needed and what would work. Right, so very little capacity or resource to any kind of evaluative effort about what kinds of interventions are working the best in order to best allocate the scarce resources. And therefore, we conclude from all of this that business as usual is not sufficient and that we need to work better and smarter together. But that given the talent and resources of all kinds in this community, we're up to this challenge, and so we've been out, and what I'm going to actually suggest that we do, so I'm going to just very quickly tell you the kinds of things we've been hearing, suggest that we maybe get into a circle so we can see each other, because we've got a nice bit of time here that we can answer your questions, but that we can also talk about what we see happening and what we think is most influenceable. On the major challenges in housing, there's a lot of stuff starting to happen. It's of the ad hoc variety. There are a lot of citizens starting to meet, studying it, and also some private business people stepping up to say that they want to take the lead on building more housing. And there is a need for, there's a sense that there can be more engagement from the county, and that there are, maybe Susan can say a little more about this when we get in a circle, but we heard a lot about this yesterday in terms of the disconnect between what could potentially be available to the county and the sort of relative geographic and psychological isolation of the valley. Nonprofit scale and sustainability, there are any number of things that, you know, ideas for how do we raise the capacity. Again, we heard a lot about this yesterday at the county, that something like the capacity to have a skilled grant writer who could write grants to request money from the government. Mostly the organizations are too small to have that kind of capacity. So maybe funding grant writing capacity that organizations that could be shared among organizations is the kind of a kind of thing that, that would help. There's no volunteer clearinghouse here. Many organizations rely heavily on volunteers. There's not a single place one could go to figure out what the volunteer opportunities are, especially for newcomers who come to town. Some of the local organizations are very interested in could there be a collective giving day, you know, a sort of philanthropy day. On coordination, I think many of you know Sustainable Sonoma is launching, and La Luz is one of the partners of that with the Chamber of Commerce and the Ecology Center to begin to look at how these the complex issues could be connected better. There are some folks, because of the report, got interested in reviving a group that used to meet of the presidents of the boards of nonprofits, connecting with each other more. Someone has brought forward the idea of a human services roundtable that would bring together the organizations working on poverty, the nonprofits with the government, with the government agencies, and sharing information and figuring out when there are moments that there might be a funding available, how the valley could get its share. And then the re-granting organization roundtable is the idea of the Sonoma Valley Fund, Impact 100, the Rotary, the Ventnors. There are a number of organizations that take money from lots of places and give it out in different places. They maybe need to coordinate better as well. And then evaluation information. We think there are any number of things that could be done to help create a culture of data so that we actually understand what we're doing. The Sonoma Valley Fund gave grants to six organizations in an effort that was about building their capacity. La Luz is one of them. And four of those organizations are working on their data systems. Three of them are building a joint data system because they believe they're serving the same youth. And how would they know that if they don't have a way of tracking these together? And that's the kind of thing that, rather than thinking just one organization at a time, by looking at the organizations, by looking across, we may be able to begin to look at the unit of analysis being, are we meeting the community's needs, not just trying to keep each organization healthy. We need that, and we need to look more ahead. So that's some of the kinds of things, some of these things are already happening, and some of them are ideas. But as we go through this process, what we feel is that we're collecting ideas and hoping to see who will take them up. And we will, at the end of this process, kind of report back what we've heard. But I say we're kind of in the middle of it. Could we interest people in maybe coming, you know, just kind of coming around?
Yeah. It would be much more interesting if you all talk to each other than if you talk to each other. So, I'm not sure.
The board's getting involved in the last
meetings are. You know, kind of looking and assessing and...
Probably there's some, you know, for institutional giving, when you have foundations, they have the capacity to do that themselves. But there's only, you know, there's maybe only one foundation of its size in Sonoma Valley. Almost 100% of giving is individuals, and think about what you do when you give money. You got data?
So it's a little bit more emotional?
Yeah, it's relationship-based. It's where people work, whether they have a certain board, or organizations help their kid, or, you know, individual giving tends to be not based on data.
Okay.
And then organizations tend to raise money the same way they have always raised rather than searching out new ways.
So have you been any need to demonstrate effectiveness of money giving once an organization folder is?
Well, so that's actually the point that we're at, I think, in this community, because in a very small town where there are not so many numbers, if you looked here 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, I bet those numbers would have been much smaller, right? Mm-hmm. It's all growing, the need is growing. And so you get to a point where people who are getting money start to stand back and say, gosh, I don't really know what works or not, right? And how would you know, right? And so they're starting with anecdotal, but you start to hear that more. Government actually wants that kind of data. And so when you're looking at the interface between nonprofits providing services and getting government money, or donors getting more sophisticated, and collaborators like Impact 100, and the vendors and growers asking for more data, the deal is that the nonprofits need support to create that, because they don't have the capacity, given the quote, they're in the service business, they often don't have the capacity or the skill to do it, right? And that's not their fault, it's just that they're not big enough to.
So there almost needs to be the layer of giving. So to understand
what you have to think, that's why we think actually some of this kind of thing has got to be a community solution, not just an organization by organization, because then you just pit the organizations against each other, right? Certainly, large nonprofits and larger foundations deal a lot in data, but it is expensive. It is not, you know, cheap to do if you would have. But in this community, most of the giving has historically been relationship based.
And the two holes that we really see are in data, needing more information about our community, particularly in special areas of need that we have found. And secondly, in evaluation, which is part of the data, how do we, as we know that organizations are too small to do the kind of evaluation that even they would like to do. So perhaps that may be something that can be done collaboratively by putting together the databases. And those are the two big holes that
And some of the data that's needed is frankly hard for nonprofits to think about and obviously the cost of providing the services. Right? So it may be that the thing that you're doing, you really believe in and you've always done and it's really good, but how much does it cost to do it compared to doing something else? And that kind of more sophisticated, you know, financial analysis, most nonprofits don't do it.
Yeah. I'm going to put a couple of comments over that I can do briefly. One is that, you know, I hope that this effort wouldn't end up recapping the type of dynamic that seems to be happening in the school system where parents and citizens feel like they're dealing with a top-down type of direction of what they need, rather than having their input solicited from the grassroots level, which a lot of people. So I think that that's, you know, a possible, you know, risk of this. And I also like to point out for a housing, affordable housing committee, that I'm a member of the Sonoma Valley Housing Group, and that group was founded before I got in with the from the Spiritual Action, and it's a secular arm of out of the Methodist Church. And we all work for no money, and we advocate for affordable housing, and I think that we've made some difference, and we're part of also the Sonoma Valley Action Coalition advocating for immigrants' rights. And then I also wanted to ask about the percent of people in the valley who made the area of median income is are there like, just for example, is there like 70% of people who make 60,000 or less, and there's a smaller portion who make the most? So when we're talking about area of median income, that's actually the majority of the population.
What we were able to pull out was the 31% below 35,000, the 31% at 100,000, and the 9% at 200,000. If you want to put a median on that, you know, it you lose the detail, but if we were to break it out, it would come out to about, what, 56 or 70. But that doesn't tell us what we really need to know in terms of who's doing what, as you know from your housing study.
Mm-hmm. And then
Does that answer your question?
More or less, yeah, because it's my sense that there's more than the area median income. You think, there's 50% of the people make 60,000 a year.
Yeah.
You know, because you're thinking median, you're thinking the middle. But I think that in reality, there's probably more people in the valley who make less than that.
Exactly.
And the median is a number that's skewed by the
median is skewed, which is why we broke it into high and low.
And then I'd like to ask your help or solicit your interest in that recently the City Council had an agenda item about the Sonoma Valley Visitors Bureau and agendizing to have a discussion about the role of tourism in the valley. And so I think that, and you mentioned that there are interdependent issues and a better coordination. And so this is, you know, that those groups say that they're all benefits and no costs. And if I look at the Tourism Improvement District report for the City Council meeting, the packet, and it's all benefits and no costs. So it would be interesting if you could get involved and contribute to that discussion. There's a City Council meeting this Monday where they'll present that, and there'll be an ongoing conversation. So I think that you could really contribute to that discussion by educating all parties who are interested in that so that they can kind of come more together.
So we can talk more about what we think we're able to do. What I can say is that it's very clear to us it's going to take a lot of different kinds of leadership. And thank you for what you're doing for the housing and immigration. Questions?
Dealing with tourism is not our strong suit.
A lot of questions planned.
Yeah.
So I think I saw that you talked about the thing of demand and the supply side compliance study. I think I saw on the supply side you didn't quantify the amount of money that's available. Was there any effort to quantify the need?
No.
So
EDP was not, EDP did not do anything.
So the reason I ask the question is this slide here looks to me as if, you know, it's more of the same kinds of incremental kinds of solutions we've been doing in the past. But I think that the thing about your study, which is so compelling, I haven't read the study, I only looked at, you know, news stories and executive summary. But the message of your study is that there's this gap between the need and the supply. And so when we start to talk about what we're going to do next, it feels to me like we always need to have some sense of proportionality and prioritization so that we don't just keep doing the same kind of stuff.
Can I say one thing about
need?
I think on a need basis, it's far more than income. But the income gives you some indication of where the biggest holes are, and you can go from there. But also have the school, Unified School District, for all of the individual problems that are going on right now, the data that gets collected by them can be very helpful in terms of establishing need.
I guess I'm talking about the need for housing, like what would it cost to produce the housing necessary to meet, to get us into some kind of proportion. And well, it just feels like there'd be some just reality used in the discussion of that happens.
So, I had a similar question. Sometimes when you look at the numbers, you can approximate. Sometimes that approximation is valid or not. But if we just say that it's roughly 20% of the population is living below the poverty level, out of the poverty level, that's right.
31%, yes.
31% of that population. And we know that, we know what the population is, and the valley is 37,000. Well, that's pretty, that starts to give you an idea of the number of people that are in need. And if you make a guess as to what the amount of money needed to bring them up, either for money or the services, to be at above the poverty level, maybe multiply that by $10,000 per person. So 30% of 46 million, let's call it 43,000, right? And you take 30% of that, you get roughly 15,000 times 10,000 people, times 10,000, we don't do that, that's 1.5 million bucks.
I'd love to hear more comments and questions and
yeah, I think just building on a couple of points that were said, I keep going back to your initial prompt, which prompted the study, which was, how can you preserve and enhance the character of this place? Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, what does that mean? What is the character that we're trying to preserve and enhance? Is it that we want to reduce poverty? Is it that it doesn't matter what the employment rate is, but we want gainful employment? Is it that we want everybody to be housing secure? So I kind of wonder, and this is back to this gentleman's point about who is not in the conversation. And so when I look around the room here, I think there are people that are not in the conversation. I mean, I know that the report was very limited, the frame was limited in terms of how much you could do, but the data is extremely compelling. But I think who's not in the conversation are our families who are living in poverty. And how have they seen things change? And what do they need to be more housing secure or food secure? I mean, we work with the students at the Sonoma Valley District, and I cannot tell you how many students go to school hungry. And I think that if they could be part of this narrative, they could be included, I think you could maybe define what that character is and work very inclusively together on what the broader goals need to be. I mean, just another comment. I think, again, this data is very, very compelling. I really thank the fund for doing this because I think what it illuminates is the power differential, once again, between philanthropy and between people who are living in poverty. And the nonprofits have been trying to bridge that. But the nonprofits have experienced over many, many years the starvation cycle. And I think, Catherine, in your work, you know this, right? And how we try to make ends meet. So I think it's not doing the same that we have been doing, it's investing more in very strategic goals here so we can bridge that power differential. And then I think if there's any next step that could happen to bringing more data, it's focus groups with our families and who are living in poverty. I know that anecdotally we have that, but that could bring really powerful data to the table as we're trying to sit down with the government. And you know, there is a lot of money in the government that just isn't touched because nonprofits and communities don't know the different funding streams. And there could be a tremendous amount we could do if we had a collective effort around that. So anyway, I just
what was your name?
I'm Kim. Ms.
Yeah.
Kim from House of
Greece. I'm here from House of Greece. Nice to meet you. The kind of things you guys are raising is why we're doing this, right? Two particular things that you said, and it goes to the level of effort. I think, and I'm speaking for myself, right? So we have a board of people. We did this report on behalf of our board. The Sonoma Valley Fund will have to decide which piece of this it can take on. It's another of the starting nonprofits, honestly. We launched a board of essentially your connected to the community foundation, but any money that we would be able to use, we would either raise ourselves.
Yeah, exactly.
Have them know that you're thinking, if you die, would you leave us?
But there are two things here. There's Sustainable Sonoma is the only effort that I know of at the moment that's going out to do the thing that you just said, which is to say, what are the goals of the community? What's the vision of the community? What does character look like? You know, characteristics, your rights, your word, your cloaks, a lot of things. What do we want for this community in the next 15, 20 years? What is the community we have now? What's the community we want to build? That requires a complex and difficult conversation the community has to have. Who is authorized to do that? Who's vision? Right? What we get is little fragments of it in political battles, in governmental bodies that are actually just stand-ins for the larger debate, right? I think Sustainable Sonoma's vision, as I understand it, is to come out and begin to provide forums and have that kind of conversation more broadly. But they'll need support if they're going to succeed in doing that. And so that's just one thing.
Could I just also add that both the city and the county will be doing updates of what is the master plan.
The city is launching its master plan process, which will be one place that is happening. But the city is only a quarter of the valley. Susan can tell us about what the county planning processes are. I had a couple of things to say, but I want to get these other voices in. You had your hand up.
Yes, just speaking to what you were speaking about Sustainable Sonoma, I know that the county was doing a couple years ago upstream investments. Basically, Sustainable Sonoma is doing what the county already started. I don't understand why the county has come up here to bring those initiatives when, you know, it has the treaty where it has, you know, preschool, you know, getting kids ready for preschool, for kindergarten, making sure that they go through high school so they're going to be the sort of thriving adults. So I don't know, because I looked at the website, so I don't know if the initiative or the conferences are still going on actively or not. That would be something that they could lead with Sustainable Sonoma, because they already have done that job, especially when it spoke about a couple years ago about bringing in community schools. So I was just wondering that part of my mind.
There's a lot to say about the interface with the government on this particular thing about upstream. Did you get any one of you guys want to say something?
I'm not quite understanding your question. I'm very engaged in upstream investments. As a supervisor, I work with them, and there is an effort now to combine upstream investments and health action. And let me just explain for many of you here. A number of years ago, before I was elected, the work supervisors quite rightly said, looking at the projections of the number of folks entering into the justice system, especially the juvenile justice system and then the adult detention facilities, we can't run our way out of this. Therefore, we have to very intentionally and purposefully make other decisions on investments upstream to divert the potential for especially our young folks moving into the justice system. So we've been in a lot of engagement with the philanthropic community, the community foundation. A lot of county departments are really still looking at that and figuring out how we can incorporate that into just about everything that we do as a county, not only an organization, but a community. But you overlay that on Health Action, which was another initiative started by the board, and you may be involved in that, bringing in all of the cities and the health partners, looking at what we can do as a community to increase the healthy outcomes for our community. And so we have these two parallel initiatives, and we thought last year that we need to come together and merge the initiatives so that we can really incorporate the whole philosophy of upstream investments into healthy action and everything that we do. I'm one of the folks who consistently look at the upstream investment philosophy and the process of the portfolios and the leading our nonprofits into an analysis of evidence-based that makes it evident to everybody that this, in fact, is a very effective practice. And we collected well around the Sonoma Valley County are now engaged in the conversation of recognizing how challenged our nonprofits are, especially in Sonoma Valley, with their lack of capacity to not only understand what the county is doing, what the funding streams are, what the how to respond to the RFPs that are solicited in the community, how to create a really significantly impressive grant so that we would create those partnerships. We're missing we're trying to identify those gaps and figure out what capacity we can build to help our valley nonprofits be far more competitive, in fact, to some of the folks that are already successful in more of the mainstream.
So one of the things that we heard yesterday when we sat with some of the folks that Susan gathered is that when the supervisors meet and there's competitive funding, all that 101 quarter of people, they're there wanting to be a part of it, but they just don't see anybody who's known about. You know, so that's where you get the kind of advocacy. You know, so it's this is obviously a complex thing, but there is something here in that. You guys are doing
that. Yeah, and actually, the more I listen, the more complex what I'll say gets to come. Because I think that Kim has made the most important point of the evening, with regard to who needs to be bringing information and decision making, not just their stories, but their requests, what they need. And I think that the difficulty, not the shortcoming, I think the upstream investing has been wonderful. Its shortcomings that it postpones to another generation a social change that needs to happen. So although we want to see the children graduate and go to college, get degrees, and at the moment we're still happy to hire their parents at minimum wage if they're lucky. And there's a huge change that needs to happen there now, but it's a social order change. And when people talk about the character of the valley and what do we want to preserve, it's an even more complex question because I saw this in Women's Springs residents, and this included a fair number of Latino people came to a meeting where we sort of did a straw poll about which of the possible designs for the springs of three models that have been in a wonderful grant that Susan's gotten for us to address the corridor and have a vision for how springs will grow. Well, there's a tendency to want the smallest, prettiest, nicest springs. But the biggest buildings and the high rises that are in some ways so offensive are what are needed for people that have homes here. So there's a tension that is a huge issue.
It's like what you were saying, preserving the culture. Preserving, you know, quality of life, what does that mean, for example? Yeah, because it means a lot of different things. But I actually had a question about I did read through the study, and I was thinking that you had also concluded that an element that is missing and is needed is self-governance for the students.
Self-governance.
We pointed out that that the valley, that as the natural geographic place that people live doesn't exactly match the political, you know. Mm-hmm. So Susan comes closest to representing, represents the whole valley, but also has other people that she represents. The city has only a piece, and so it means that the governmental solutions, which, you know, there are all kinds of things you have to do about that, but we didn't. We don't know enough and certainly didn't weigh into that political battle.
Let me just say, that is the Lewis did a means study. I think it was 2 years ago.
It's more than that now.
Is it 2 or 3 years? But it's on their website, and it was a kind of different kind of methodology, but for general information, I think it's something you want to look at.
So a couple things I want to just, that I think are good instruction. When I think about where we are right now, we've got to figure out what is influenceable, right? In the sense that, so there's some things that aren't influenceable. You can't put a barrier up down it. To your point, until tourists not come to Sonoma. Right. Tourists are going to come to Sonoma. What hotels is influenceable, I mean, what they do once you're, you know, the other things that are here are influenceable. Sometimes the conversations happen where it's like every possible solution, and we've got to figure out right in this moment in time, where's the strategic thing that you can do, things that you can do that have the most impact, that are influenceable, that you can organize people around, and organize one of them. So the, I think in a way, it's a strategy problem in a way. What we see, and what everything we've seen since this report came out just underlines, is that we have this gap, right? We have all these people, and now I'm going to come back in a second to the issue of how we get voice, but we've got all these organizations, 60 or so in the valley, and more from outside, working really hard, really at a program level, providing services and running programs on the ground. Then you've got government and philanthropy disconnected often, not always, because students are really connected, but from what's happening on the ground, trying to figure out what to do. I mean, people are just sitting there, like you say, well, I'm on $800,000 this year, where am I going to get it? Right, how would I know? But all that money, and then there's a lot of money on the sidelines. What we're missing in this community, that many other communities have, is a middle layer, right? Communities have universities, they have organizations that work in the middle as intermediaries, whose job it is to look around, bring people together, staff the community strategy.
Unions, churches.
Yeah, large businesses.
Large,
but it's organizations that have scale that are operating in between at this level, right? And larger nonprofits can do that, right? Often have the capability when they're larger to do that. But if you're a $500,000 to $1 million nonprofit, no way do you have a resource to do that. So if you are going to bring people together to have a visioning thing, if you are going to organize a very carefully run place to create a safe space where people could voice what they think from the poor families. Who's going to do that in this community? Where does that leadership come from? I frankly don't see it. Doesn't mean it's not here, but that's the issue. Where is the leadership going to come from to then raise the money to do the things that aren't just in them?
That's where I think we bring the nonprofits together. Who knows that question? Who in this room can work together to put that, to bring the voices into the room? And I think that that's one of the things that the nonprofits in this community, and let me just, I'm very candid, and I think that this issue where we're in standing at the hallway of the Sonoma Mountains not there, and I'll be very honest, when we were starting to serve, and we've always served students from Sonoma for many, many years, but when we came in to serve as high school students, we were looked at from other nonprofits, like,
who are you?
And there were even donors who said, well, you're going to take money away. And we said, we don't want the money. What we want to do is be able to collaborate and serve the students. We brought in a lot of donor funds to do that. But to this day, I think it's been very difficult to bring the nonprofits together. And to say, how do we bring the voices of your constituents into this process? And I do think it's a leadership issue, and I think the leadership has to move beyond the boundaries of their own organizations.
Yeah. How did that happen?
So when I think about the President's Council that you're bringing together, I think you need to bring together the CEOs and the executive directors of these organizations with government, with the nonprofits, and say, how do we do this? Because there's tremendous talent within the nonprofits, and I think that that's one thing that the Valley can invest in, is a collaborative, collective impact group. We're doing this in other places, and yes, it's like herding cats sometimes,
this is a small community of 47,000 people. I believe it can be done here if we can bring in the executive directors into one room.
They do meet.
I want to agree with his comments, but
could I just clarify something? Yes. And that is that we are not pulling together the board presidents. Two people who heard our presentation decided it was something that should be done, and they are taking the leadership to do it. We're working with them, but it's their initiative.
But I think that's the key. It's what Sonoma Valley Fund can do, what Sustainable Sonoma can do, what bringing the President's Council back into play can do, what the ED Roundtable can do. If it refocuses a little bit, and as a recent ED, I can tell you that it had gotten to the point where 5 to 8 executive directors would show up out of 40 organizations based in the Valley. People aren't buying into it. And it had degenerated from being a real, let's solve problems, to just updating on what's going on. So it needs revitalizing. It's not any one entity that's going to do this.
Right.
It's bringing all of them together and approaching things on an issue basis.
Yes.
Education and supporting youth is one issue. Housing accessibility is another. Planning for a senior explosion beyond what it is today is another. And even within those separate issues, there's tremendous overlap and collaboration that needs to happen among them. What you have done is call to the attention of people who are listening, who have had a chance to hear you. And really, that's what tonight is about. It's not to drill down with the families. It's to get more individuals like us hearing the message, but to bring more people aware so that we can fund with people the other levels of organization that need to move forward, because you can't do it all.
Well, yeah, yes, sir.
I'm slightly uncomfortable at the fact that I've been out of town for 9 months.
So what?
I've been out of town for 9 months taking care of a sick relative, and I rewrite to a community meeting out of Serve Blue. And to my shock, I know half of the people here. And so I think that there's a selectivity of the kind of people who want to come to this kind of meeting and want to deal with these issues, and are for one reason or another having the background or the competency or the skills to be able to do so, who are well intended, but are in their own gap, as I am, with a whole bunch of people that I'm in touch with, such as elders, such as children, such as poor people, such as bigger people, such as people who recently let loose from the prisons or sent to the prisons because they're not functional. There's a whole group of folks here who I'm not in touch with, but I can converse with you guys. You know, I taught in university and distills in another setting like that. So I'm saying, can we have another meeting? Can we speak about these things in greater depth? This is wonderful, but it's not enough for me to get to some of the issues that I think are underlying our race and our class and our power and our whiteness and our hatreds and our phobias and all the things that have set up 100 years of history in Sonoma Valley that we're reaping the benefits of and the curses of. You know, Sonoma was set there and the valley was set here, and there's been a historical change of that for 150 years or so. And now there's a turning of that, because probably for the first time there's more people, more power in the valley than in the city of Sonoma. But the creation of the city of Sonoma, the creation of the valley, as citizens we've heard and said a dozen times, is a function of letting the county become a government for urban areas and creating suburbs which have no governments and have no taxes and have no ability to run themselves. So that's why there's not that middle section that other towns and cities have, because they have no history of that. And if we're to have a sustainable, truly sustainable at a cultural and democratic level, we're going to have to educate that generation that's coming up. We're going to have to re-engage the builders. We're going to have to re-engage everybody, not just the folks that are like me, educated, and capable of donating, you know, or can participate. but a whole group of other folks that I'm not always comfortable being with, frankly. And so I want to have that discussion as a basis for then another discussion that I want to have, and I'm just inviting you to that discussion and asking you for it. I've created a think tank and a research center and an institute. It can really put out facts and data and so forth on an ongoing basis as a cultural history for the Springs and for the Valley, because one of the things that tied communities together, and those of you who know me, that I'm absolutely obsessed with villages, that's the core of where we can go. The Valley can be a cluster of villages. Each of those villages happens to be a census tract and happens to be a neighborhood, but it's more romantic to call it a village. And yet each village learns about itself as it used to be able to do because there was multiple generations that lived here. See, what we've lost, what they're romantically asking for as a quality of life, is let's have 1950s Sonoma in a way, 1960s Sonoma in a way, or 70s Sonoma in a way, because that small town feeling is just hard to beat. But with a million tourists coming in here, who don't care at all about small town feelings, except to come and do what we've been doing to leave, we have a different kind of proposition in front of us. And in 30 years, this place will look much like an unrecognizable place, or it could, in fact, take the sustainability and take the population that's here and take the education and the knowledge and actually be a leader for not only us, but for many other places about how do you deal with cyber world and tourism and racism and cultural problems and economy. We have more capacity here to deal with these significant problems than anywhere else I've found in California or in the United States, right here.
Well, I'm going to have to cut you off.
I know. So I'm asking for another meeting to discuss that agenda because it goes to a lot of the questions that you're asking that we need to get into. But I want to applaud the fact that you're having this convening. And I think your role as convening discussions is the best role for you to take right now. Because out of that, it'll sprout other possibilities.
So, what I can say is that we feel immense humility about what we do with Poe and what certainly I've known since of what right before. I do increasingly think it's an issue of the revolution. I think that we're searching for. How it is that this community can find, I think the thing that they just said is, it isn't about all nonprofits. There's all nonprofits do different things. I mean, the Pest Lifeline and the arts groups and the poverty groups are, you know, not doing the same thing, right, all the time. And so I think somehow how we come together to try to, the thing about incremental versus big, sometimes you get to the big steps by taking some new smaller steps and succeeding at things. And so we're trying to discern, like the rest of you, and are so incredibly grateful that you're all here and that we're engaged in this conversation, because we're sure we're going to do that if we don't have a conversation. I wonder, Susan, you know, if you just look around and see, got to get in your car and drive, and got to curse real loud, but is there anything you wanted to say before?
No, I just. As I said to these great folks here, this is the beginning of the conversation. Having served 4 years in office, I've come to the realization that we in the Valley need to do things differently. And so the first step of doing things differently is working actually coincidentally on a parallel track to what the Sonoma Valley Fund is doing, is trying to identify the structure of how services are provided here in the Valley, who funds the services. And I've known in my gut that the geography of Sonoma Valley puts it at a disadvantage. It doesn't have to be a multi barbed wire to be physically separate from the service providers of the central core. It is a mindset. And so what my focus is to bring the county structure of health, human, and the community development commission down here to interact with many folks in the valley to understand, first of all, we provide a lot more services than what has been reflected in the report, because many more services are provided at the health center and certainly at our own office with the loose. And I think we can try to quantify that, but I'm more important in understanding what the needs really are, how to serve, and how we can work together to provide those services, and how we can work together to build the capacity of the nonprofits so that they are far more capable of understanding how to outreach to a larger world, both the county and the philanthropic world, because I think we could be, should be doing so much more in the valley, and we will be working together with the city and with all of you to achieve that.
Rich, can I make an announcement before we break up tonight? I don't know if this is the right time. The county, the project of the county is actually an initiative of the World Health Organization. It's called Age-Friendly Communities, and it's Age-Friendly Sonoma County. It's being implemented by the Council on Aging. And there is a survey. Their deadline is tomorrow, but they're willing to extend it until the 25th for anyone who's age 50 or over. And I can send you a link if you can put it on your website. Yeah. If any of you could respond to that, it would be very helpful.
Well, I just was the one who started. Well, I said I just started with it, but I'd like to end with it, which is really to thank you all for coming, because for all of the effort, and Catherine is the one who kept track. We had about 1,000 hours of work in this. We stopped counting, I should say, in 1,000 hours. But the really important thing about it is getting it out into the community and hearing from you what we do with it. And starting this conversation.
Is there an action step that you're inviting us to take?
Reflect on what action step we want to take. That, I mean, we're doing the same because it's going to take a lot of different steps, and
I don't think too presumptuous.
Yeah.
Well, is there
read the whole report.
Okay. Is anyone here connected with Sustainable Sonoma? So I think we should know more about that.
Yeah, they're launching. Have them come and do a presentation.
Yes, well.
Yeah.
But that's not facetious about thinking about what you're going to do. That really, we're not going to be the answer. We're going to try to figure out which thing we can do, right? And how it is to move forward together. What we are committed to doing is reporting after we've done this outreach process more about what we learned, right? And what's going on. This really is going to be about the leadership that emerges and the resources that we can work.